Good afternoon and welcome to Spirit of New Ministries. I'm Pastor Charles Young. Thank you for joining me for our Wednesday afternoon Bible study. Before we get into the Word, let's take a moment to look to the Lord in prayer. Eternal and all-wise and all-loving God, we come today offering praise and thanks for the blessedness of life, most importantly, of eternal life. And so, Lord, we pray your presence today, that you would grant us wisdom and understanding as we delve into your word. Speak to our hearts, our mind, and our spirits, that we may grow, learn of thee, and become more like thee. For that, we give thanks and praise, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, welcome. Thank you for joining me this afternoon as we continue in our series entitled Becoming Spiritually Fit. We are continuing in this study. We've been talking over the past few weeks about what it takes to grow in our spirit, to become spiritually fit, so that we can live lives that honor God and we can live productive lives in the faith. Tonight we're going to be talking about growing in goodness. Growing in goodness. And by goodness, we're talking about the word in the Greek, it's the word agathosyne, agathosyne. And agathosyne means uprightness of heart and uprightness of life, of goodness, of kindness, of virtue and benevolence, that which is absence of unrighteousness or unholiness, but that which is anchored in the reflection or an attitude, a condition or a state of being. So we're talking about how we conduct ourselves, how we operate based upon attitude, based upon how we reflect on God's word and how we apply God's word to our living. And we operate out of a foundation of goodness, that which is reflected of God. Because God is good. He's always good. He has always been good and will always be good. So as Christians, as men and women of God who were made in the image of God, we ought to reflect that same character of God, of goodness. And that's part of our Christian development, of our maturation, our growth. And so tonight we're going to talk about growing in goodness that enables us to become spiritually fit. We're going to begin with a passage out of the Psalms, and actually we're going to look at two different passages from the Psalm. The first out of Psalm 34, and we're going to look at verse 14. All of our passages tonight will be from the English Standard Version. Psalm 34, verse 14, and then we're going to go to Psalm 37. But here in Psalm 34, the 14th verse says, "Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it." Now notice the psalm writer makes this declaration. He says, "Turn away from evil and do good." So what he's stating is that this is a position, an activity that we have the capacity to fulfill. He says, this is something that you do. He said, turn away from evil, which means if he's making this declaration, he's saying that this is something that we have the wherewithal to achieve. We can do this. This is something that God desires. This is God's purpose for our lives, that we turn away from evil and by contrast, do good. We're not to have the proclivity toward evil. but we're to move and operate and to function contingent upon the good. And in doing so, we're to seek peace and pursue it. We're to go after it. So what the psalm writer is reflecting is that there's a direction. We need to turn away from that evil direction and then pursue good, turn toward the good, do the good, think about good, operate in goodness, and pursue it, chase after it. Make sure that what we're going, what we're going after in life is function and contingent upon goodness. And the psalm writer makes that same declaration as he goes to the 37th psalm, and he says in verse 3, he says, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. So once again, he's laying out the same perspective when he says, trust in the Lord, because in the Lord therein lies the foundation of goodness. It's only in God, only in the Lord, where we find goodness. And in like manner, as the 34th Psalm declared, we are to do good. It's something that we have the capacity to achieve. We're to do it. And we can do it because we have God's Spirit living in us, who equips us, empowers us, equips us to be able to do the good that the psalm writer is talking about. As we dwell in the land, we befriend faithfulness. We walk in the faithfulness of God. We pursue it, just as the previous verse says, in pursuing peace. And so all of this is foundationed on the goodness of God. As we are Christians and we reflect God in all of our character, we know that God is good, we in like manner ought to function in goodness. Goodness is that foundation as we walk in the Word of God and as we stand on the biblical principles. Goodness is that which we have the opportunity and we now have the responsibility of living out of. We can do it because God says we can do it. He gives us the charge to do it, and he gives us the ability and the capacity to operate in goodness. When you look at the book of Proverbs, and there in the second chapter, verses 8 and 9, we again, as Solomon now makes the declaration, he says, guarding the paths of justice and watching over the way of his saints. Then you will understand righteousness and justice and equity, every good path. All of this comes from understanding what the Word of God reflects with respect to justice, what's right, what's fair, what's pleasing to God, and how we pursue those things. And in doing so, we're able to watch over the saints. We have that ability because we're looking at the Word of God as our plumb line, as our foundation, as the premise out of which we operate. And so therefore, when we're doing the right thing, we have also the responsibility of watching over the saints, of providing an environment of equity and justice and righteousness. And he says, then you will understand righteousness and justice and equity. Why? Because all of that is foundationed in the Word of God and in the goodness of God. And he says, if we do that, we will be able to walk on and pursue every good path, which gives the distinction that there is a not so good path, a path that does not lead to righteousness, a path that's not foundationed in goodness. But praise be to God, there is that path of how we live our lives, that path of how we think and how we operate and how we plan and how we execute the good plans of our lives, contingent not upon what we think or what the world says, but contingent upon the Word of God. The Word of God is life-giving. It is life-affirming. And it shows us the right way to live and the right things to do. As we continue in the Bible, we look at the book of Jeremiah, and there we're going to go to the 6th chapter. And once again, all of these passages that I'm giving you are references that you can look to that will give you a solid foundation as to how to operate what the Word of God says with respect to goodness and how we're to grow in goodness. We're to mature in goodness. That's God's purpose, And that's his plan for my life and for your life. Jeremiah, the sixth chapter, we're going to look at verse 16. And there in verse 16, it says, "Thus says the Lord, stand by the roads and look and ask for the ancient path where the good way is and walk in it and find rest for your souls." But they said, "We will not walk in it." This is a very powerful passage of scripture, and it really speaks, it confirms what we've just looked at before. When we look at scripture, we ought to look at them as building blocks, how we can foundation word upon word, principle upon principle, precept upon precept, as to how we apply them to our living, and we can walk according to what the Word of God says. Now, we've been talking about this good way, how we're to walk in it, how God equips us. It's his desire for us to walk in it. Now, when we look at this passage in Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah makes the distinction here. He says, "Thus says the Lord." This is God's declaration. This is God speaking through Jeremiah to the children of Israel. And he's saying to them, "Stand by the roads and look and ask for the ancient path where the good way is." And all that Jeremiah is saying is that God has laid out his principle for years and years and for generations and generations, and we need to stand and look to see where the good path is. We need to watch to see God's hand guiding us in the way of righteousness. As such as that was the case then in the Old Testament times of the scriptures, such is the case even today. We who now live in the New Testament of God's Word, we're to look for the ancient path, the right way, the way that pleases God, the way that confirms God's purpose and plan and desire for our lives. And so we need to be mindful. We need to be watchful. We need to be wise as foxes, but innocent and as sensitive as doves, that we're walking in the ways of God and we're doing the things of God. And so we need to pay attention that there are philosophies and theories and theologies that are floating around that are in direct opposition to God's word. And so we need to be sensitive to those things. And we need to be watchful. We need to be prayerful. God, show me what is the right way to go. Show me what is the proper decision to make. And therefore, I look for the ancient paths, those things that are anchored and foundationed on God's word, and not the winds of doctrine that float by, and the things that are faddish, those things that come and go with the times and with the wind, but that which is foundational, that which is anchored, and that which is sure, which is God's word. And so he says, stand by the roads and look and ask for the ancient path where the good way is. And he says to walk in it. And in doing so, we find rest for our souls. We find rest and contentment, we find peace and strength in the ancient paths of righteousness with this God's word, which is God's word, which will always be God's word, which is the sure path that we pursue. And then notice at the last portion of that 16th verse, he's talking to the children of Israel, and this reflects their unwillingness to do what the prophet says for them to do. He says to find the ancient path, walk in the way, pursue it. He said, in doing so, you will find rest for your souls. The sad part of this passage is that the children of Israel decided not to do it. They complained and they made idols. They worshiped other gods. They did things that were in direct opposition to what God's word declared for them to do. And so he says there, but they said, we will not walk in it. That was a definitive posture that they took. They made the decision that in spite of what the prophet said, and this wasn't the first time. When you look at the prophet Isaiah, you look at the prophet Jeremiah, you look at different prophets that came through during the Old Testament, and God had used them to direct imperatives to the children of Israel. They made the decision on multiple occasions that they were not going to walk in the way that the prophets declared, which reflected God's word and his will for their lives. We now move to the New Testament, and we're going to look at the book of Romans, and we have a couple of passages out of Romans. Now, the reason why I give you Old and New Testament passages is because we find that the same principle is relevant throughout the Old Testament and through the New Testament. It doesn't change. It doesn't oscillate or vacillate, but it's the same through the Old Testament scriptures and the New Testament. And I really labor to make sure that you understand that, because there are those who think, well, that's just an Old Testament principle. It doesn't relate to us. It does not apply to us as New Testament Christians. And that's just not true. That's just a lie from the very pit of hell. We as New Testament Christians are to pay attention to and adhere to those Old Testament principles that are still relevant and still apply to us as New Testament Christians, which means we are to grow in goodness. It was reflected in the Old Testament, and what we're going to see tonight is that it's also reflected in the New Testament. We look to Romans, the 12th chapter, and there in verse 21, let's look at what Paul says to the saints at Rome. He says, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Now that's very similar to what we found that the prophets were talking about in the Old Testament. And so here we see in Romans chapter 12, verse 21, that Paul, as he writes to the saints there, he says, "Do not be overcome by evil." Conversely, overcome evil with good. Once again, we have a choice. We have that which Paul says to the Corinthians that they have the opportunity and the obligation to fulfill, to perform. They can do this because as New Testament saints, they are saved. And he's talking to the Christians here. He's talking to the brethren. And he's saying to them, overcome the evil. Do not be overcome by it. But you overcome evil and you do what is good. This opportunity that they have is not just an opportunity, but it is also a responsibility. God had given them by way of the Holy Spirit, by way of His Word. He gives them the ability to be able to not be overwhelmed by evil. Now, how do we not become overwhelmed by evil? We don't subscribe to it. We don't give into it, and we don't play around with it. We recognize evil for what it is, and we turn in the opposite direction as Paul recommends. And he says, instead of being overcome by evil or overwhelmed by evil, but we need to overwhelm or overcome evil by doing what is good, by living according to the Word of God, by walking by the power of the Holy Spirit, by praying without ceasing, by studying the Word all the time, even as the Old Testament says in the book of Exodus, that we are to meditate in the Word of God. God told Joshua, meditate in the Word. Do it day and night. Never let it leave your mouth. And allow the Word of God to be the foundation out of which we operate. That same Old Testament principle is what Paul is talking about now to the Romans. He says also in the 15th chapter, there in verse 14, there he says, excuse me, "I myself am satisfied about you, my brothers, that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and able to instruct one another." Boy, that is such a powerful passage. He's saying that he recognizes that as he's been ministering to them, as they have been taking in God's word, as they have been foundationing themselves on the principles and the precepts of God, and them allowing that to be the premise out of which they operate, Paul says, "I'm satisfied with your growth. I'm satisfied with how you're doing. I'm looking at you, and I'm seeing how you're growing in your goodness. You're growing in faith." And he says, "Because you are full of goodness." They have walked in ways that are pleasing before God. Paul is encouraged by their Christian growth, by their maturation, by how they are anchoring themselves in the Word of God. They're not allowing themselves to be blown about by different winds of doctrine. And a lot of that was going on at the time when Paul was writing to the saints at Rome. And because they have blocked out those things, they blocked out the things that were not of God and those errant philosophies that were floating through and all of those different winds of doctrine that were coming by, they've locked that out and they're focusing on God's word. The same thing that we ought to do today. We ought not be embracing these different winds of doctrine that are floating through that says that there's alternative ways of living and it's okay for us to live these ways. It's okay to just embrace different themes and theories and doctrines and ideologies that are in conflict with God's word. It's just okay to kind of embrace those. And we see it all the time. We see it on television. We see it in the news. We see it in entertainment venues. And we see it all across the spectrum that people are just embracing ideologies and thoughts and things that are in conflict to what God's word says. And people say, well, it's okay. It's all right to embrace different thoughts or different modalities of living, and that it's all right to do so. Well, it's not all right to do so. People are operating by the way that says, well, there's different paths that lead to God. No, there are not different paths that lead to God. There is one path, and that path is Jesus Christ. He is the Son of God, the one who died on the cross for our sins. And because of that, if we trust him with our hearts and with our lives, then we will have salvation. And that is the only way that we can get to God and the only way that we can have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The Bible tells us there is only one way to get to the Father, and that is by the Son. And so what Paul is saying to the saints here, he was satisfied that they have now caught on to the gospel. They've now accepted it. And he says they're doing the right thing, and because of that, they are now full of this goodness. And this goodness, it allows them to be filled with all knowledge, and because of that, they are now able to minister to each other, to instruct each other in truth, to encourage each other with the word of God so that all of them are walking by the same spirit, they're standing in the same faith, and they're living in the same principles that are pleasing to the word and that are pleasing out of the word of God. And Paul is saying, this is a good thing. This is pleasing to God because you're walking in ways that honor him. And now you're able to instruct each other, which is what we ought to be doing today. We ought to be instructing each other, encouraging each other, inspiring and comforting each other with the word of God. When we see a brother fall, as the book of Galatians says, we ought to be mindful in order to help lift up that brother, help lift up that sister, but by the same token, make sure that we're not sinning as well, and by the same token, falling into sin in like manner. We ought to be standing on God's word. We ought to be strengthened by God's word, and therefore, we ought to encourage those saints that are weak. As Paul says, you ought to be able to instruct each other. We ought to be able to instruct each other in like fashion. We go on now to the book of Corinthians, and we have several passages out of the first and second letters that Paul writes to the Corinthians. We're first going to go to 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. And there in verse 23, Paul follows up on this same theme that he was writing to the Romans, the same thing that Jeremiah was talking about and Solomon and the psalm writers. The same principle is continuing here in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 10, and the 23rd verse. There, Paul says to the saints, all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Boy, he's saying something very powerful here. Note what he is saying. He's saying that because of the laws of the land back then, which is also the case right now, there are certain things that the law says we can do. But all of these things that the law gives permission to do are not helpful. There are things that the law said then that it's okay to do, and a lot of them were still operating out of the Mosaic law. There were laws that were established in the different locations that they were, in the different areas in which these people lived, here in the city of Corinth, in the city of Rome, and a lot of places like Ephesus and Philippi. In Thessalonica, a lot of these different places where churches were being started and the churches were growing, they had rules and regulations to live by. They had laws that governed the locale. But these laws were made by man. And these laws, even though it said you could do certain things, these certain things were not fruitful for the Christians. They were not productive. They were not helpful. And they did not sow into the spiritual realities that the Christians were to live by. Such is the same thing now. There's laws that say we can do certain things, but it's not good for us. It's not encouraging. It does not help us to grow as Christians. There's a spirit of lawlessness that allows us to go about and do certain things, but they're not helpful for us. And so Paul is saying that there are things that are lawful, but they're not helpful. There are things that are lawful, but they're not they're not things that build us up. They don't edify us. They don't strengthen us. They don't help to build our spirit man. And so Paul says we need to be mindful of that. We need to be watchful. That even though the law may say that there are certain things that we can do, it doesn't give us license to do them. We need to be mindful of what the Word of God says, as opposed to what the laws of the land are. Now, yes, there are things that we need to govern ourselves by. But we also need to realize that every law that's out there is not beneficial for us. It does not help us to grow in our spirit, man. It does not help us to mature in our faith. And so as Christians, we need to operate in the spirit of discernment. And I talked about that not long ago. That spirit that helps us to decide, to decipher, to differentiate and distinguish which things are good versus which things are not good. Those things that are applicable to our Christian growth and needful and helpful for us to grow and mature in our faith versus those things that are not. And so Paul makes that declaration and that distinction. As we move to his writing in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, there we're going to look at verse 33. And he says, again, kind of in the same modality, he says in verse 33, do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. That is such a real powerful statement. It is applicable for how we're living today, and everybody ought to take note of that and govern ourselves accordingly. We need to not be deceived. That when we hang out with people that are operating by principles and precepts that are in conflict with God's word, it corrupts moral character. We need to not govern ourselves by the mores of society, by things that are in conflict with God's word. We need to make sure that we're not just palling around and just hanging out with people that are operating in conflict to God's word. They're not applying the principles of God's word to their living, and so we just kind of hang out with them because they're buddies or they're associates or whatever the case is, and we kind of pile around and we develop what I call soul ties with them, and then we start governing ourselves by the way they behave, and we kind of start becoming lax in our morals. And therefore, that's why Paul says, don't be deceived. You cannot hang out with bad people or people that operate out of bad morals and continue to operate in a moral faction. He says, do not be deceived. Bad company, people that operate out of non-spiritual or non-biblical or unchristian values, he said, they're going to ruin your character. We are going to be affected by it adversely. So he says, make sure that we understand that bad company will ruin good morals. In his second letter to the saints at Corinth, there in the 9th chapter and the 8th verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, Paul continues. And when you look at Paul's second letter, in each of his second letters to the churches, he gets a little more firm in his application of the scriptures, and he's really locking in and trying to get them to understand you really need to pay attention. His first letter to these different churches, like to Thessalonica, you know, when he was writing to these different churches, the first letters really kind of laid some foundation, but then his second letters really start to lock in on how they were to live, and he's really letting them know that there are things that they need to pay attention to. So here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, he says, And God is able to make all grace abound in you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times. He's saying something very powerful here. He says, you may abound in every good work. Again, we're talking about the goodness of God and how we're to operate in goodness as well. Let's kind of pick apart what Paul is saying here. When he says in verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound in you. In other words, God is able to supply you with all that you need in order to be successful and victorious in all of your living. Remember when Paul was afflicted and he had gone to the Lord three times and asked God to take away this affliction, this thorn in the flesh, so to speak. What did God say to him? He said, in essence, I'm not going to take it away. He said, but my grace is sufficient for you. And here again, we're talking about this grace, the same grace that Paul had made an application. He had made a petition that God would relieve him of the thorn that he was dealing with, the thing that was troubling him. And here God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, God is able to make all grace abound to you. In other words, you are going to be able, even in the midst of trying and difficult circumstances, God is going to equip you. He will empower you. He will strengthen you. He will encourage you. And he will inspire you by means of his grace to be able to cause you to abound, to overcome, to be able to be strengthened and empowered regardless of what circumstance you may find yourself in. And he says, you will have all sufficiency. You'll have everything that you need. You will be empowered. You will be strengthened. You will be enlightened in order that you will be able to, at all times, be able to overcome and abound in every good work. Do you know what that says? That says that there's never a time when you will not have what you need in order to live and to operate in goodness. You have what it takes. You have by power of the Holy Spirit. You have by power of God's word, which is that sure foundation on which we stand, to be able to abound, to overcome, to be more than sufficient in every good work, which means that we have the ability to succeed and to be victorious in everything that we pursue. We have that ability. God provides it. He provides with sufficiency everything that we need in order to be successful and victorious in every area of our lives. Paul then goes to the Galatians and he writes to them there in the fifth chapter. And in verses 22 and 23, he encourages them. Again, Paul's writing to all of these different people, to the Romans, to the Corinthians. Now he's writing to the saints at Galatia. There he says to them, chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. And this is a familiar passage. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Which means there is nothing that says that we're not to operate in these things. There is nothing that prohibits us or keeps us from being able to, to function in full capacity with respect to these elements of the fruit of the Spirit. I ought to be able to operate in abounding love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and, in our topic for the night, and in goodness, in faithfulness, in gentleness, and self-control. The Word of God says there's nothing that keeps us from being able to be successful and victorious in all of these areas of living. That's good news for the child of God. That means that God has empowered us, he has equipped us, and he's given us not just the opportunity, but he's given us the mandate and the wherewithal to be able to fulfill the mandate, to operate in abounding areas of all of what the fruit of the Spirit provides for us. And we then go to the book of Ephesians. Again, Paul is writing these letters out. He wants them to know. He's giving them information so that they can live powerful lives in Christ. Such is the case with us. The same principles that Paul is expressing in these letters are the same principles that the Holy Spirit empowers us to live by as well. And that is good news for the child of God. Ephesians chapter 5 and the 9th verse. Look at what Paul says here. He says, "For the fruit of life is found in all that is good and right and true." The fruit of life is found in all that is good and right and true. All that the Word of God reveals to us provides that light. The Word of God is the light unto our path, and the lamp unto our feet, and the light unto our path. And so that light helps us to see the truth of God's Word and how all that is good and right and true, which we're to live out of, which we're to operate by, which we're to be faithful saints by the Word of God, by the truth of the Holy Spirit that helps us to understand God's Word, and we are able to live in what is good, what is right, and what is true. We have the ability to do that, and we have the responsibility to do that. And God equips us and empowers us to live in what is good, what is right, and what is true. Finally, our final passage for the night finds its home in Paul's letter to Titus. And in Titus, we're going to look at the second chapter, and we're going to consider three verses out of Titus chapter 2, verses 12, 13, and 14. And just to give you a little background, Titus was one of the saints that came to Christ under Paul's ministry, just as was the case with Timothy. And so here, Titus is an evangelist. Titus is one who has the charge to communicate the gospel and to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul had been ministering to him. Titus had given his life to Christ under Paul's ministry. And now Paul is sowing into Titus the principles and the precepts that will help him become very fruitful in his ministry to others. And so here, Titus says, "Training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works." That's a mouthful. There's a lot that's there, but it really speaks to the same principle of what we've been talking about, this growing in goodness. And Paul is saying to Titus, his son in faith and his son in the ministry, he is saying that God trains us and he renounces ungodliness. As God is training us up, we are to train others, and we are to stand on the foundation of how God helps us to renounce, to speak against, to live against, and to declare against all ungodliness and all worldly passions. And that's why the scripture says we ought not love the world. We ought to love God. And those who love the world, that the love of the Father is not in them. And so we ought not give ourselves over to the systems of the world, to the principles and precepts of the world, which operate in opposition to God's way, his word, and his will. So he's saying we're to be trained up. We're to renounce all ungodliness, anything that comes against the word of God, anything that is reflective of things that are not godly, those things that are not holy, those things that are not righteous. We need to renounce those things along with all worldly passions. And conversely, we are to live lives of self-control. We're to live upright lives, godly lives, and we're to do it in this present age. Paul was saying that to Titus then, but the same principle is applicable and relevant to us today. In this present age, we are not to give ourselves over to ungodliness or worldly passions, but in this present age, we are to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives now. We are to wait for our blessed hope. We wait with an expectation and anticipation of our appearing of God our Father, of God our Savior, who is Jesus Christ. We are awaiting the arrival of Jesus Christ at the time when the great trump of God is going to sound, as it says in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is going to come back, and at that time we're going to be caught up in the air to meet him. We are awaiting the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who has given for himself, he's given us as a ransom, that all lawlessness, and therefore we are to purify, and we are purified because he did this for himself to give him a purified people that he gave in order that we may be a possession for him. And we are to be zealous. We are to be excited. We are to be pumped up so that we can be godly people doing a godly work that God has commissioned us to do. Christ has purified us for himself. We are his possession. He did it so that he can be glorified, so that we can be blessed, and so that we can be about the business of doing good works until the very time when he comes back. We ought to be looking with an eye to the heavens, but we ought to also be looking with another eye to be doing good works to the pleasure of our King and our blessed Savior, who is on his way back here. We ought to be looking with an eye to the return of Christ, but also looking to do good works until the time that he returns. And that's why this whole premise and this process of living and growing and maturing in goodness is for every child of God. It's for you, it's for me, it's for all of us who call ourselves Christians. And so as we end tonight, this passage of Titus, Paul was saying to him that we ought to prepare ourselves, we need to equip ourselves, and we need to posture ourselves for good works, that we would be that purified possession that Christ created for himself, that we are to be performing and pursuing good works until the time when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ comes back again. Now note, this is an affirmation passage that our Lord Jesus is coming back. It is an absolute certainty. And because we know that he's coming back, there is a mentality that we ought to have, that we ought to be operating and pursuing good works until his return. Beloved, I pray that this information has been helpful for you, that it helps you to really posture yourself in a position of knowing that we ought to be growing and operating in goodness. And in doing so, that helps to equip us and empower us to be spiritually fit for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, thank you so much for joining me this evening. We're going to close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for this opportunity to open your word. Thank you for speaking to our hearts, our minds, and our souls. Continue to grow us, equip us, mature us in ways that are pleasing unto thee, and that we may become a good witness for the world. Father, we thank you for your word. Continue to minister to our hearts and allow us to grow in faith in ways that are pleasing unto you. For that, we offer our thanks and praise. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Once again, thank you for joining me here at Spirit of New Ministries. I'm Pastor Charles Young. Look forward to you joining me again, first of all, on Sunday mornings at 10:15, and again on Wednesday afternoons for our Bible study. God bless you. And may God keep you.